It's far from uncommon to run across content claiming to detail the best exercises or best workout programs for hypertrophy. For example, you might have heard certain compound exercises such as back squats or conventional deadlifts being described as the most effective for building muscle. Other times, they are called the king of all exercises. However, I want to describe why I think when overviewing the current exercise selection literature, as well as the literature on muscle hypertrophy stimuli, the concept of there being the best exercise or the best couple of exercises for hypertrophy makes little sense. For one, there does not appear to be an optimal exercise modality for hypertrophy. A recent meta-analysis by Heidel and colleagues established free weights and machine exercises were comparably effective for hypertrophy. Adding some extra detail, one study by Schwanbeck and colleagues compared an exclusive free weight program, consisting of exercises such as back squats and easy bar curls, to an exclusive machine program, consisting of exercises such as Smith machine back squats and machine biceps curls. After 8 weeks of training, increases in thickness of the biceps and quadriceps were similar between both programs. Bodyweight exercises are likely no less effective too. Kikuchi and Nakazato found that bodyweight push-up variations and a 40% one rep max flat barbell bench press evoke similar pectoralis major and triceps thickness increases after 8 training weeks. Note, a 40% one rep max load is perfectly fine for muscle hypertrophy. Quite a bit of evidence indicates loads between 30% and 85% one rep max produce similar growth, provided repetitions are performed to volitional failure, which was done in the Kikuchi and Nakazato study. Moreover, though notable limitations with muscle excitation studies exist, a number of them find when push-ups are load equated to bench presses, either via comparing light load bench pressing to bodyweight push-ups, or via comparing weighted push-ups to heavier load bench pressing, both exercises similarly generate excitation of the pectoralis major, triceps, and front delts. The findings of these various studies make sense. Let me explain. The current literature on the stimuli of muscle hypertrophy indicates mechanical tension may be the primary hypertrophy stimulus. Mechanical tension is equal to the force generated by muscle fibers. Components within muscle fibers, called mechanosensors, can detect the force produced by a muscle fiber and thereafter transduce these forces into a signaling cascade that results in muscle fiber hypertrophy. Following on from this, to maximize a muscle's growth, we'd want to recruit as many muscle fibers as possible and have them sustain at least decent amounts of their respective forces for a fair duration. The key point here is that this can be accomplished with any exercise modality. Your body possesses no mechanism to know if free weights, machines, or body weight is being utilized to stimulate muscle fiber recruitment and force generation. So long as you perform between roughly 5 and 35 repetitions, and those repetitions are performed with 3 or fewer reps in reserve, with a free weight, machine, or bodyweight exercise, the aforementioned conditions are likely achieved. That is, the working muscles in the exercise likely experience maximal muscle fiber recruitment, and the individual muscle fibers likely sustain at least decent amounts of their respective forces for a fair duration. Before moving on, there is another component to mechanical tension worth touching on. This is passive tension. When muscle fibers are sufficiently stretched, a component within it called titin produces passive tension while elongating. A rubber band can help you conceptualize passive tension. When stretching a rubber band, it produces tension, analogous to force, to try and resist stretch. Titin operates comparably. Mechanosensors, potentially within titin itself, can detect this passive force and transduce it into a signaling cascade that produces muscle fiber hypertrophy. Generally, exercises that involve a good stretch of the working muscle or muscles can involve high amounts of passive tension. Numerous free weight, machine, and bodyweight exercises can involve a good stretch of the working muscle or muscles. For example, a barbell back squat, hack squat, or pistol squat all accomplish a good stretch of the quadriceps and gluteus maximus. Another reason why the concept of the best exercise or exercises makes little sense is for optimizing growth across many regions of a muscle. exercise variety is likely important. Costa and colleagues allocated 22 detrained men they had not trained in the previous 6 months into a non-varied or varied group. Both groups trained for 8 weeks. The non-varied group performed the exact same exercises for their muscle groups 3 times per week. The varied group, across the 3 days, performed different exercises for their muscle groups. Both groups trained each exercise with 3 sets of 8 to 12 repetitions, using 90 to 120 seconds of rest between sets. Before and after the study, thickness of the upper, middle, and lower regions of the rectus femoris, vastus lateralis, elbow flexors, and triceps were measured. Overall, although increases in thickness were similar between both groups at a couple of regions, increases at other regions favored the varied group. Accordingly, this data demonstrates performing around 3 different exercises per muscle group each week results in greater growth across more regions of a muscle. This is logical. Typically, different regions of a muscle, or the different muscles in a muscle group, do not function in complete unison. Rather, the different regions of a muscle, or the different muscles in a muscle group, are activated to different degrees during movements that contrast in some way. For example, Nunez and colleagues established performing calf presses with the feet rotated outwards results in preferential growth of the medial gastrocnemius, while calf presses with the feet rotated inwards evoked preferential growth of the lateral gastrocnemius. As for an example on the muscle group level, although back squats seem to do a great job at stimulating the vasti muscles of the quadriceps, that is, the vastus medialis, intermedius, and lateralis, they fail to meaningfully target the rectus femoris. Yet, leg extensions or reverse Nordic curls, which involve more isolated knee motion with little hip motion, preferentially grow the rectus femoris. On the account of all of this, by training a certain muscle group with a few different exercises that vary in some way, either via the angle used, joint positioning, or hand orientation, you most likely end up growing more regions of a muscle. Therefore, saying there's a single best exercise for a muscle misses the notion different exercises collectively contribute towards more uniformly growing a muscle. The final reason I think is worth discussing on why the concept of the best exercise or exercises makes little sense relates to individual differences. With the same exercise, not all individuals recruit and stimulate the same musculature to the same degree. Stronska and colleagues' data indicate the relative recruitment of the pectoralis major, triceps, and anterior deltoid differed between individuals on the bench press. Some individuals preferentially recruited the pectoralis major, some the anterior deltoid, and others the triceps. Likewise, Boyer and colleagues observed during Nordic curls and stiff-legged deadlifts, recruitment of the various hamstring muscles differed amongst individuals. These findings highlight the notion that just because one individual grew a certain way with one exercise, this does not necessarily guarantee the same will occur for you. As a final point, I should emphasize that by no means am I saying every single exercise in existence is optimal for building muscle. Unquestionably, there exist factors that would result in certain exercises being more favorable for hypertrophy. It's just that even with these factors in mind, a whole host of exercises are still highly effective for hypertrophy. Even so, let us briefly overview factors that could make an exercise more or less effective for hypertrophy. If the muscle you're attempting to train is not the limiting factor in an exercise, chances are it's a suboptimal movement. Take a Bosu ball pistol squat. Your balance and stability are probably going to limit your performance more than force production from the main muscles. Consequently, a whole host of other exercises that provide a more stable environment are more optimal, be it back squats, hack squats, or assisted pistol squats. Another factor relates to achieving a stretch. The current evidence is increasingly leaning towards the idea that exercises that achieve a good stretch of the working muscle or muscles may be a more powerful hypertrophy stimulus versus exercises that only train the muscle in a shortened length. There are an array of exercises for each muscle that involve good stretches. Finally, personal preferences for one reason or another may be important too. If certain exercises, either due to your natural anatomy or injury history, are uncomfortable or painful, chances are you're better off performing other movements. In a different scenario, if you're someone who utilizes the mind-muscle connection, and you find you're able to best achieve this with an exercise like a dumbbell curl as opposed to a barbell curl, hypertrophy outcomes could potentially be better with a dumbbell variation. That brings us to the end of the video. As always, thank you for watching. I hope you found the video interesting and informative in some way.